I recently got myself two spools with 5 meters of white LED strip that I want to utilize in a future portable lighting project. So once again, it was time to choose a suitable battery type. Due to their superior gravimetric and volumetric energy density, I wanted to either use lithium polymer or lithium ion. The advantage of lithium polymer batteries though is that you can easily get them in pre-made packs that feature multiple cells and thus possess a high enough voltage to power the LED strip directly without boosting the voltage. Only problem is that the LiPo batteries can be a bit dangerous if you're not careful. So wouldn't it be useful if we could combine common 18650 lithium ion cells in a similar pack? Well, of course it is possible, and in this video I will show you how to create such a battery pack, how to attach a BMS, aka a battery management system, and how to create a decent housing for it all. Let's get started! The 6 lithium ion cells that I will convert into a battery pack are INR18650-25R with a capacity of 2500 mAh each. To get close to the required 12 volts of the LED strip, I need to place 3 of them in series to create a voltage range of 12.6 volts when fully charged and 7.5 volts when completely discharged. In addition to that, I will add a second battery to each cell in parallel in order to double the overall capacity of the battery pack. So in the end, we will have a 3S 2P battery pack with an energy of 55.5 watt-hours, enough to power 5 meters of the LED strip for 1.6 hours. Now to connect these cells properly, we need a bit of nickel ribbon. Mine has a width of 5 mm and a thickness of 0.15 mm, which will easily carry the required 3 amps for the LED strip. Now there are two ways to attach the ribbon to the batteries. The first and recommended way is to use a spot welder, which utilizes a burst of energy in a very short amount of time to weld the ribbon to the battery. A spot welder itself can be bought for around $200 from China, but since I still had two modified microwave transformers laying around from a previous hacked episode, I simply removed their worn out cable heads, added new cable shoes, attached the bolts with 3 nuts, 2 washers and 2 toothed rings to the cable shoe, and finally clamped a nail as an electrode in between the 2 toothed rings. The first modified transformer though, with an output voltage of 1.7 volts, was not powerful enough to create a proper weld. And the second one, with an output voltage of 7.5 volts, was a bit overpowered for the job. Even after decreasing its amount of secondary coil turns, and thus lowering the voltage down to 4.7 volts, I simply was not capable of creating a proper weld. So we must go with the second, not recommended option. Soldering. Before doing that though, we firstly must measure whether the voltage of the parallel cells is close to one another. Otherwise, one of them could charge up the other one with an unhealthy amount of current. Then I created shorter length of the nickel ribbon, pre-tint those on both sides and used small pieces of P240 sandpaper to break the positive and negative terminals of the batteries. Afterwards, I added a bit of solder to each contact, which already shows you why this method is not recommended, because it heats up the battery, which can lead to capacity losses and other problems. But nevertheless, I then inserted each battery pair into their designated spacers and used the previously created ribbon pieces to connect them in parallel. Afterwards, I organized the 3 battery pairs in this arrangement to add the missing 2 nickel ribbons, which are mandatory for the series connection. All that was left to do was to add an additional piece of the ribbon to the positive and negative terminal, as well as the 7.4 volt point and the 3.7 volt point, according to the scheme. After double checking that all the voltages at the taps made sense, the positive and negative tap received an unnecessary thick 10 AWG cable that connects to a XT60 connector to later supply the main current to the load. The 7.4V and 3.7V tap, however, are important as well, since they need to be hooked up to a 3S balanced connector, just like the positive and negative terminal shown in this arrangement. And just like that, we have a lithium-ion equivalent to the 3S LiPo battery, that we can now balance charge through the help of an appropriate charger. But we are not finished yet, because we can still add a BMS circuit to the battery pack, by simply gluing it on top of the pack and soldering the battery terminal wires to the circuit according to its labels, we just added a lot of useful protection features. For example, by supplying a charging voltage of 12.6 volts to the output wires, the pack begins to charge, and the BMS will cut the charging current once one cell exceeds a voltage of 4.24 volts, to prevent an overcharge. Only problem is that the circuit does not balance charge the rest of the cells, which makes a balance connector still mandatory. But on the other hand, the BMS also cuts the discharge current when one cell reaches a voltage of 2.3 volts to prevent an over-discharge. Also, there's an overcurrent protection of 26 amps and thus, obviously, a short circuit current protection. And with those added protection features, the battery pack is finally complete, but it still looks a bit fragile and unprotected, even with a couple layers of Kapton tape. So I went ahead and designed a decent housing for it with 123D design that I then 3D printed with my Delta printer. After 6 hours, the print was complete, and I slid the battery pack inside it, secured it with a drop of hot glue, mounted the XT60 connector and balance connector with 2-component adhesive to the lid of the pack, and once that was dry, pushed it in place and secured it with 2 M3 bolts and 2 nuts, which I placed inside the lid beforehand. And just like that, you can make your own lithium-ion battery pack. I hope you like this project. If so, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.